taking it for granted, because it can slowly slip away, and next thing you know, you don't know, you won't know that it has happened, and you start filling the void of it, because it is very, very important to our spiritual souls, okay? But I'm just going to let Stephen take over, introduce the panel, and enjoy. But one thing, we on Saturday, we are having curatorial talks at 2, so you're all welcome to come back for that. Our first one was with Talisa Fleming from the Smithsonian. Saturday's with Becky Hart from the DIA. So please come and enjoy that talk also. I'm going to pass it over before we give it to Stephen.
Really, really quickly, we'll be passing out little note cards. You can write your questions down. Then I'll collect it around 7:45. To pass it on to Stephen, and he's going to ask the panelists. So if you have any questions for the panelists, write them down on these note cards, and we'll get it to Stephen to ask the panelists. Thank you.
Okay, let's get started. As George said, my name is Stephen Henderson, and I'm actually, I want to thank him first for asking me to moderate these panels. This is the third of the panels, and I have been really impressed with the panelists on the first two panels, and I thought we had really great conversations both times. I think we have a panel tonight that will facilitate a conversation that's at least as good as the first two. So with that, we'll introduce the panelists. Sitting to my immediate left is Malik Yakini, who's the founder and executive director of the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, which operates a 7-acre urban farm in Detroit's Rouge Park. Next to him is Halima Cassells, Detroit-based artist and activist who holds leadership roles at many community-based organizations, including the Oakland Avenue Artists Coalition, North End Soup, the Free Market, and the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network. Next to her is Ernest Zachary, founder and vice president for development at Zachary and Associates, a Detroit-based firm specializing in all phases of economic development, with specific expertise in market research, historic preservation, commercial revitalization, community planning, green design, and more. Next to Ernest is Kathleen Collin. Is it Collin?
Colin.
Colin. Director of Investments at Oppenheimer & Company. Colin serves as the chapter president for the National Association of Securities Professionals Detroit and is the point of contact for ICAP New York for their emerging minority and female-owned investment management and consultant community. And next to Kathleen is Catherine Kelly, publisher for the Michigan Citizen, a publication aimed at progressive-minded African-American readers, a publication which began in 1978, was started by Catherine's father, and now operates exclusively as an online publication. So the first question will start at this end, then the next question will start at the other end and come back this way. Malik, how do you define the type of gentrification that you see happening in Detroit right now?
The type of gentrification that I see happening in Detroit is the type where white people, young white people who have more income than the average Detroiter is moving into places that are renamed Midtown and places like Downtown and Indian Village and North Corktown. And there seems to be a tremendous amount of capital that's being invested in those areas, and we see tremendous amounts of development in those areas. And of course, when that happens, rents are going up, residents and some businesses are being pushed out. And then we have the rest of Detroit, which apparently is being left to languish. And it seems that the strategy of the elected and appointed leadership of the city seems to be that if we develop these other areas, that somehow wealth and prosperity will trickle down to the rest of the city. I see no evidence that that has ever happened or that it will happen in the future.
We can either pass or we've got three mics, so we'll share two of them.
Okay, can you guys hear me? Yeah, okay, great. So I'm going to describe it as the consumption side model of gentrification, where newcomers are coming to consume a lifestyle. So it's the grit, it's the cool, it's the generations of cultural legacy that Detroit has pumped out to the world that newcomers are attracted by and can kind of put on this Detroit versus everybody machismo exterior and exude because now they're a part of it. And so what I see happening also is a situation where the corporate government is doing what James Baldwin called Negro removal. So we have two sides of the coin. Welcome everybody who's not from here, and for people that have been here for generations, y'all got to go because the new Detroit is happening. So we have policies where certain folks are getting tax abatements and rent, you know, paid for because your corporation wants you here. And on the flip side, Detroiters are being attacked with water shutoffs, and now, most recently, it's become a felony to turn your water back on. So anybody anywhere would do that, but you know, now it's kind of like criminalizing the population for being unemployed and being sticking it out. So that's what I see currently.
I agree with Malik and what he was saying about this trickle down that we've always expected. You go back to Coleman Young's days and the investment that was happening downtown, the hope was, it's going to trickle down neighborhoods, your turn's going to come. It's nothing new. That hasn't happened. What is different today is that we have this massive interest from corporate interests, you know, so it's unheard of that one person can own 70 buildings in the downtown of a major city in America. That's a huge impact. One person is doing that and one person is controlling it. The tax credits and all that stuff, it's gonna flow there. That is, you know, that's an important investment. You know, we're gonna have the Illiches and we're gonna build a stadium. Massive, massive investment. You know, so, and you have the little ones which are also meaningful as Shinola and, you know, the stuff that Phil Cooley's doing over in Corktown. These are all important investments, and they're also dislocating in our city. It doesn't get shared. It doesn't get trickled down. It hasn't happened. So what we have is a focus of a lot of development without, you know, some people participating in the benefit of that development. But it isn't in the neighborhoods. Nobody's figured out how you take these models. And, you know, instead of buying 70 buildings, getting somebody to buy the old school that's in the middle of the neighborhood and rehabbing that, or putting in commercial in neighborhoods and things like that. We don't have that. I mean, so the fact that there's a gentrification, there's great power behind that what's happened to Detroit. How do you counter that? I don't know how you counter that, other than to undertake development in parts of the city and have some of the same forces come in. That's it. It's on.
Okay.
Well, there's one right here, too.
There's another one.
Okay, yeah. Okay, you hear me?
Yep.
Definitely, to echo what everyone is saying here, I mean, the term, I guess if you want to look at it from a scientific, because I definitely, you do your homework and there's different types of gentrification, and definitely Detroit falls into what's known as kind of concentrated, that it's all happening in one spot, and the ideal is that it is to flow from out. You know, this very much sort of like Chicago, sort of like Philadelphia. It's different from, a little different from New York gentrification. I mean, the feeling can be there, but what kind of distinguishes Philly and Chicago along with Detroit is that there's a large concentration of African Americans, and along with an old infrastructure. So it can, you know, very much be very much concentrated in the midtown, downtown area. Now, I don't think gentrification is a bad thing completely and totally, because on the positive, it's supposed to be about urban revitalization, and that's crucial in this town. I mean, no one, I don't think, is going to be, you know, tripping off of not knowing that that wasn't crucial for this town. I think what is disconcerting is when it's opportunistic. You know, that's a term in the investment community where you talk about opportunistic just like with anything, you're able to, I mean, it's large risk, but you're able to come in and kind of exploit, you know, the opportunities and the chances that are availed without really a big concern about, well, what's the big plan, what's the general plan or the moral compass for the big plan for the city. And that's what concerns me about the gentrification that's going on right now. What is the, you know, basically what is the stop and the halt and the concern for what is the bigger plan and how it fits in with the moral compass that is Detroit?
I think maybe to echo what some of the panelists have already said, I think that, you know, what we're seeing, you know, I'm a Detroiter. I left for a few years, but I'm essentially a Detroiter, and it's kind of amazing to see when you grew up in Detroit, you had these really nice black middle-class neighborhoods, very solid. You had a variety of neighborhoods within the city. But what we see in terms of this version of gentrification is how wealth is being created with the combination of capital and white skin privilege. There was a study that came out, a Harvard study, about how gentrification reinforces segregation. And I think what's amazing, as a longtime Detroiter, when we look at what's going on, it's like for some places, the only thing that has changed is, you know, there used to be black people that occupied these buildings, and now there are white people and white skin. And that in of itself has allowed a value to change. So we have also this wealthy group investing downtown, as you point out, owning 70 buildings. And what has started as, it's almost like this decision to create value. And when a certain group of people decide that there's value there, it moves from a perceived value to a very real value. And the real dollars that come from that real value are accrued within a group of people that have historically been able to benefit. So I think that's my concern, and that's kind of what I see with what's happening with gentrification in Detroit.
Okay, everyone on this panel is an enterprising member of a community here in Detroit, spearheading initiatives that benefit existing Detroit communities. So talk about the ways that you're working in your respective fields or in your respective areas to maintain inclusive development in Detroit. What are you doing to make sure that Detroiters get to participate?
Let me preface my answer by not skirting around what I see as being the major issue. And that is that there is absolutely, in Detroit, in the United States, and globally, a system of white supremacy, a system that gives favor to people who are defined as white. And that manifests in all of the major institutions. It manifests in how we see economic development taking place. So one of the first steps in correcting that is an open acknowledgement that that exists, and not kind of this skirting around that we constantly see, but really, you know, dealing with that in a very direct way. So having said that, I don't want to, you know, appear, as George said, to be a victim, you know, although I think it's important that we point out systemic oppression. But at the same time, we have a responsibility. This is kind of a twofold thing. So we have a responsibility to dismantle the systemic oppression that exists. But at the same time, we have a responsibility to take, we have to take responsibility for ourselves and for our communities. And so the organization that I represent, the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, is one that very much believes in community self-determination. That it goes beyond the question of inclusion for us, but it's really a question of how do we mobilize our community in order to, one, determine what our aspirations are, two, to put in place the vehicles to realize those aspirations, and two, how, and three, how do we make alliances with those who have the capital and the resources to really make all this stuff fly. So, again, I think one of the critical factors is that we have a very open, honest discussion about this system of white supremacy, how it has functioned historically, how it the role that it's played in putting us where we are today, because we really can't fix the problem until we look at it in a very forthright way.
Okay.
Okay. So I would describe my life's journey and all the work that I do as uplifting my community. And let's see, I started off as a painter and then, you know, decided, oh, this is a great empowerment tool for young people, and got involved with DBFSN, and I was like, I can't paint anywhere. It's hurting all of the natural life of the planet, so what else can I do? So most recently, I'll share this with you. I'll pass it around, but I do need it back. I'm a part of a project called the 1 Mile Project, and this is a magazine that we've produced. And the idea is, how do we uplift local makers, local artists, local businesses, people who have been here for, you know, 50 years? And so these people are highlighted in here. And I also, can I pass this to you? And just pass it around, but I do need it back. The idea of just a conversation convener and a space creator. How do we have conversations where circles get to interconnect and collide so that folks with access, because I think when we talk about gentrification, we also look at this idea of capital, but it's not all about capital. It's often about access, and not just access to capital, but just access to different people, different circles. You know, how do we put ourselves, our products, our work in position to be seen by many people, to be valued? And when we talk about, you know, this white supremacist thought construct, we are constantly devaluing our work, ourselves, and projecting that way, sometimes subconsciously. So everything that I do is about uplifting. I'm working with a group at Insight Focus right now, 15 young people. We're building a car that goes 100 miles per gallon. And a lot of people are like, that's crazy. Yeah, it is. We're going to do it. And, you know, I work with another organization, Center for Community-Based Enterprise. You know, we are going to incubate co-ops in the city of Detroit where workers have equity ownership of the company that they own. And again, working with DBCFSN, we are bringing to the North End community something that is owned by the community, a food co-op, where consumers are the owners of the space. So that's just a little bit of what I do.
You know, when you're in development and or into living in the city, not to value what each and every person in the city can give to the process is kind of ignorant, right? I mean, so when you don't pay attention to the history of all the people, you really sell yourself, your efforts short. And the same thing goes into the future. This area that we're in was called Sugar Hill. It was nicknamed that by some of the musicians that were in this area. Right across John R. was a place called the Flame Show Bar. There you had Billie Holiday, Billy Eckstein, you know, Della Reese. You had a hall of fame of all these musicians that were here. Berry Gordy's sister was taking pictures of the people. Berry Gordy recruited all his musicians from this area. They lived in this area, after hour spots that were here, you know, where they had the music, and it was all here. It was a lively area. It was a wonderful area. When we came here, there were murders. There were two murders across the alley. There were people. Yeah, it was really bad. It was really, really bad. And so George and I hit here, George Nambi and I hit here about the same time. And we started thinking about, how do we move this area forward? And one of the things we thought, why don't we honor the past? Why don't we really take advantage of what has happened here? And we named it Sugar Hill. And so the whole intention of moving forward was based off of the art that was really part of the African-American community and using that to move forward. So here we have George, and if I'm not mistaken, he's African-American, and I'm not. You know, so we work together, and we're partners on projects. We do this stuff. But it's, you know, I'm saying, looking forward, not to move forward with people of the talent of George is stupid. Not to pay attention to the past and the contributions of the people that live in the city is stupid. So that's the direction that I come from.
Okay. As a director of investments at Oppenheimer, or just not even limiting myself to that title, as a passion, I advocate on behalf of people across minorities and females for equal access involved in the whole process of basically in the investment industry. And a lot of that has to do with, like, for instance, the 7.2-mile radius that is of divine interest and where all the focus right now is for, capital, the big capital is coming in. You know, there's got to be individuals who participate in that process who look like the people, basically, who do pay the taxes, a lot of taxes in that support it. So I'll advocate on behalf of having investment bankers, minority-owned firms, female-owned firms, hopefully down the road, be able to put together the, say for instance, the urban funds that raise the dollars, that make sure, the millions of dollars, that make sure that maybe some of the, as Zachary just described, Zachary described, some of the projects that will maybe hopefully get rolled up into, say, a bigger appeal for bigger dollars, that will be found acceptable for institutional level investment. That's really what moves a lot of these things forward. You know, these pension plans, these projects that, you know, really reshape a community, a lot of it is financed by these institutions here in Detroit and in and around Detroit, that they must, the projects must meet a certain level of acceptability, that they're basically, you know, kind of deemed like class A level. You know, but then after that, once, you know, like a fund can make sure that these bigger projects get done, but then you can roll into those, under that, guys, you can roll into affinity-type projects, you know, like a Sugar Hill, like a Motown over on West Grand Boulevard, that makes sure that a culture is preserved. I think that's, you know, when I did some researching and tried to make myself more aware for me what was the biggest ill in this process. I might be going a little bit off steam, so I do apologize. What was the biggest illness is that, you know, my biggest concern is that there's a whole culture, I guess this whole notion of cultural genocide, that might be a little bit far, but okay, cultural displacement, you know, I mean, it happened that, you know, Black Bottom was not that long ago. I mean, my grandmother told me all about it, but, you know, I mean, yeah, there's economics, but then it is bigger capital that moves this whole thing. Yes, there is a whole feeling of white supremacy and all that, and I really don't get into that because I don't like it, but I don't understand it. So, but I do know one thing is that, you know, money, you know, is in the pursuit of profit, you know, is a huge motivator, and at the end of the day, you know. It doesn't really care, you know, and that's what troubles me and kind of drives me, especially, you know, trying to see my city come back after that subprime madness that really, if you want to talk about what killed our communities, let's talk about that, you know, but long and short, that's what drives me to advocate for access for individuals who would be naturally sensitized, you know, females, you know, affinity groups who are involved in the investment industry. And from that, you know, as also in my role as the president of the NAS Detroit chapter, we made education and pursuit scholarships for Metro Detroiters number one priority. I mean, we make sure our people are at the table with deals. But, you know, if you're going to come in here and you're going to do deals in our city, well, this is something that's important, and that's help our youth get educated so that they too can one day be deal makers. So access, you know, kind of advocating for access to the bigger deals or to be at the table for individuals who are natural, maybe have an affinity, towards looking out for, you know, minorities and females, or just more involvement is really where I get my biggest push from.
I think one of the roles of media is to raise questions and to highlight issues. I think policymakers have a critical role in gentrification. I think right now, Detroit mayor and city council could be very purposeful and deliberate as value continues to grow in the city. How does it grow for everyone? You know, what is council and what is the mayor, what are others doing to think about housing policy in the city, investment policy? As gentrification happens in and, you know, how to improve everyone's life, create value for everyone, make
that Detroit needs to attract more people and invest. Many people believe that Detroit's development tends to exclude people who have been here for a long time. I'm wondering what everyone, some of the new investment and some of the new people working alongside people who have been here for a long time. And I'm going to tease Malik a little bit here. Can we get a Malik Yakini to work alongside a John Hant? Both. Sorry for picking on you there. there are a lot of people working supposedly in the same space who don't necessarily see eye to eye. How do we sort of bridge that gap? I'll start with you, Kim.
Well, I find, we wound down the Michigan Citizen at the end of last year. But, you know, one of the things that I always found as a business owner in the city, as someone who represented a business with a very progressive, community-minded, grassroots voice, is quite honestly, you know, a lot of the people who have access to capital, who control the conversation, you know, really don't want to hear a lot of things that might make them uncomfortable. So, you know, you have this group of people that are very community-rooted, neighborhood-rooted, that are working, that are trying to raise the issues and make improvements in their community and in the ways that they see are real and important. And a lot of those ways are not validated by the power structure. So I found that extremely frustrating as a business owner, as someone who's reported and run a business in the city. You know, quite honestly, if the powers that be don't like what you're saying, you know, your microphone gets turned off. So I think until Detroit truly becomes a sophisticated and inclusive and open-minded place where everyone becomes invested in making sure that everyone has a place, that has to happen to get dollars to move to communities that haven't seen dollars and still aren't receiving dollars. You know, the powers that be can't be so afraid of things, of maybe losing control. I don't know what it is, but until we get more urbane, sophisticated conversations going in the city with a diverse set of players, and I mean a truly diverse set of players, it's not going to move.
Well, there's it just the harsh reality is to me, at least in the world that I operate, is that you some of the most effective way is you legislate it. Either, you know, on the state level, they do it in New York over their pensions. They're doing it in Illinois, and then you have oversight, And that's in the form, and any form of a commission, some of these oversight commissions will involve vested partners, vested people in the community, so that you make sure it says that if you're going to get some of the monies, you know, some of the monies from our pension to support your big deal, then you are going to have participation from a Malik or Stephen Henderson, who might be the head of a coalition, but you are definitely going to have your boards that make decision and vote over how these millions of dollars are going to get allocated are going to have a representation. So be that from the community, like a community advocate, but in Ohio, they have it in Illinois, here in Michigan, that will say you definitely will include diverse interests, and then you have what's called, again, oversight. And what's great about oversight is that people get grades, and if they're not meeting up to the standard, then guess what? You don't get the money. You're not gonna. So they really, I mean, they don't. It's great to, you know, from an altruistic standpoint, to hope that these people will feel good about being inclusive. But that really is not, I don't think that's really the case. If you tell them that you're not gonna get this money, and unless you have, I'm just being serious. If you tell them that it's mandated, you know, here is legislation that points to, or here are policies that are in place, here is our investment policy that states, you know, you must have this kind of a diversity at hand. Or how about this? Here's a partnership that you're gonna formulate. Now, however all, you know, I'm not a big fan of these front partnerships. I'm not. But let's, if it gets the money to trickle within that organization, and from that individual can possibly subcontract out and involve some of these smaller developers, and then they can in turn turn around and hire people within that community immediately. That's the way that you get, you know, you get some trickle down. So you I think you tie. They ultimately, they need a vote. They need an authoritative power that says, here's the way that you're going to get, you know, these big dollars to do these big projects which change communities. But the only way it's going to happen is if it has this diverse element to it. And it can be legislated, and it can be oversighted.
You can't get that legislation from this legislature.
Oh, I that's why I said there's a best practice expectation. And believe me, it's heartbreaking for me how Michigan, you know, has done. I mean, years ago, I flew in and along with some other members of NASA to advocate, you know, for what was, you know, happening there, as, you know, this takeover started, especially with the pension, a long time ago. But there is best practices, and you can have groups like NASA, or you can have even, you know, oversight commissions involved in saying, well, hey, you know, we're gonna be watching how you do what you do. But Michigan is a tough place; it really is. So,
yeah, I mean, there are community benefits agreements that, right now, for instance, with the hockey arena, they're trying to get the benefits out to for housing and for jobs and all that. So that effort's happening in. You know, they with Marathon Oil, they tried there. I don't think it worked very well, or it worked at all. But for major projects like that, I think you can do legislation. I think it's very, very difficult to bring that kind of attention to some of these neighborhoods. I mean, this is 140-something square mile city, and we tend to concentrate on Midtown and Downtown as if that's the beginning and the end of the story. To me, you know, being able to get development into neighborhoods, being able to make neighborhoods balance, okay, so you may have a nice housing area, you have a crappy commercial area, or you may have commercial, you don't have good housing. You may have a park that's not open. You may not have transportation. I mean, to talk about having a balanced community and going towards that, that's tough work, and that is not gonna come off of any community benefits. We have nonprofits. We have some wonderful nonprofits. I mean, there's some nonprofits that are at the top of the game because maybe it's easier. Maybe Midtown is a great nonprofit because you got the medical center, you got Wayne State, you got the cultural center. Not bad. But if you have a nonprofit on the Lower East Side and you're trying to do something, what are you glomming onto? What are you doing? I mean, you have empty schools and no commercial, and you've got some housing that's okay. I mean, how do you take that and you take it into a better echelon? How do you make the living in there better? It's not an easy answer. It really, I mean, it's something, I think it's the next challenge for the city to do that. Because out of 140 something square miles, we're dealing with, I don't know, how many square
7.2 miles. Development for 7.2 miles.
So what about the rest of it? Yeah. And how do we deal with it? We're focusing on things as if this is it, this is the enemy, or this is the solution. I think it's a much more complicated answer for the city and for its
which
people.
Which we are you talking about?
Pardon?
You keep saying we are focusing on that, but which we? I think it was the we described that you described, okay? Who controls the money?
No, I agree. I'm not.
It's
I'm not.
Just, not the, it's not the other.
No, no. I'm saying. I was saying the city.
Yeah,
I was
you saying we though. I'm just trying to clarify.
No, it's really. It's. Yeah, I mean, if the city's going to move forward, you know, it's got to be. I think we've got to take and put our eyes
it's
elsewhere.
Not
you got it. Okay.
To be in the present form to move forward.
Okay, so I love and respect you. I take great issue with the framing of this question. I am ideologically opposed to the framing of this question because I think it espouses the internalized racism that we're speaking against at this point in time. So the fact of we need people to come in and save us, the biggest welfare recipients in the motherfucking world, the big three, do we need people to come in and save them and restructure them? They got $700 billion and they couldn't turn it around. So why is it always on the backs of the people of Detroit who have to bear this inferiority, inadequacy, complex, like we're not good enough to create solutions? You know, I think that's wholly false. We have the most engineers per capita of any city in this country. We can't engineer our way out this shit. Yes, we can. But, you know, again, it goes to what, I'm sorry, Catherine said.
Oh, Catherine.
Narrative and media. The narrative that's projected about Detroiters is that we are inferior, we are lazy, we are not good enough to create solutions for ourselves. And I think that we never get the shine. Like, who knew we were national robotics champions? Right down here at Youthville, those young people went all the way to Anaheim, California this summer and competed against everybody else in the country and won. We are national chess champions. Our youth and our even their parents are genius, but we never get the narrative to be allowed to be at the table to uplift solutions for ourselves. And that is a systemic, corporate, overarching type of a narrative problem. And so without that, we get this blank canvas, nobody there, they don't know what they're doing, we have to go in and save them, democracy doesn't work for them. We get all of these other narratives that are able to be enacted upon us, and then we get to be playing a role of victim, which I just think is wholly unfair. And so how do we really flip that script? You never hear about GM being inept or inadequate, but they got $700 billion. All right, so that's that. Now, Kathleen brought up Black Bottom, Black Wall Street, and I'm so glad you did, because if we look at that history, Black Bottom, super tight neighborhood, with all the services that everyone would need in the neighborhood, lawyer, dentist, stores, clothing, everyone in a neighborhood able to provide all of the means for themselves. What happened was I-75, there was eminent domain pulled. They said, we need this land. They didn't need that land, could have been anywhere. But they did that and gave everyone there nothing. So whereas the Poles in Pole Town at least got fair market value for their property, all of the black people got nothing. And so we had a next generation. If you're a parent, what you gonna tell your kids? Go get a job. You know, just doing it on your own, they're gonna take everything from you. So we got a generation of people to go into the factories instead of starting their own businesses and proliferating in that type of a way. But everybody else, and this is the face of white supremacist thought construct, gets at least fair market value for their property. Black Wall Street, oh, they just got bombed.
Yes.
We know that, right? We know the history of all these things that pop up and just get bombed. All right, so we don't want to speak on that. That's kind of depressing. So what's the question?
but you know what?
I'm sorry.
I'm so glad you brought that up, because I'm sorry, Stephen. Because one of the biggest, when I was sitting and getting ready and thinking about this, I said, it's that whole, you get nothing, that's kind of like genocide, cultural
yes,
genocide.
Yes, it
and
is.
That, I know, and that was just too deep for me to really embrace. I said, well, maybe it's cultural displacement, it'll feel better. But no, and I think that's the worrying part of this whole thing, is like, cultural genocide. I mean, we are a rich Detroit. I'm not just saying African Americans, but Detroiters. This is a rich, you know, cultural town. Like George says, I mean, you know, you know, our funk, our whole ism, and to know that it can. I mean, like I said, that whole wipe out of 1960. That wasn't that long ago, you know, and. You know, I just, that's what's more fretful to me, is that it's the cultural genocide part. I don't hear it being tossed about much, and I don't, but yeah.
It's cultural genocide and it's actual genocide. I think a lot of the policies that are being enacted now are aimed at getting people out because Detroiters are so strong. Detroiters are so resilient. So, it's policy after policy that's saying, okay, get out. We have the what we want from you. We have the music, we have the legacy, we can build on this. We have the t-shirts that we can put on and proclaim Detroit versus everybody, and everybody's so tough and so cool. But actually, we want all of y'all to go somewhere else. And The fact of turning off a person's water for $150, which can easily be 1 month's bill, is unconscionable. Absolutely. If we break it all down, every person in here is 80% water. So the fact that our government had to be pranked into saying water for all Detroiters just shows that we are living the corporatocracy. We are living something other than a government by the people, for the people. And I'm gonna stop talking now. I'm gonna pass it on.
Sorry.
I'm used to being the like most hardcore person on the panel. But Halima's coming kind of hard tonight. So Mr. Henderson jokingly alluded to myself and John Hance being able to work together. But what he probably doesn't know is about 2 years ago, John Hance and I had breakfast. Oh, you do know that? Oh man, you got some real inside information. And after being one of the chief critics of the Hance Project for a number of years, he reached out to me to see if we could sit down and have a discussion. You know, I'm willing to sit down and discuss with people I disagree with. And it was a very enlightening discussion because he was very direct. And I just want to share a couple of the things that he shared in that breakfast conversation. One of the things that he shared is that what he was really trying to do was to to create scarcity by taking some of the land off the market in order to drive the value of the land up. That's called speculation. He was very clear about that. And he also said to me that this project, which is now morphed into what they call Hans Woodlands, and for those of you who might not be familiar with the Hans Project, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, he had a very sophisticated press campaign that touted this project that he was developing that was supposed to be the world's largest urban farm. He got a great deal of community pushback because he wasn't committed to urban agriculture, to organic agriculture. Residents were concerned about pesticides being sprayed in the neighborhood. And so the project morphed into now what he's calling Hans Woodlands, where he's planting hardwood trees and eventually will plant Christmas trees. Both of those things are the cover story, whether it's urban garden or trees. The real deal is controlling the land. And he in as much told me that. But he also said that for him, this is a legacy project for his daughter, because in 40 years when these trees can be harvested, then she'll be able to reap the rewards of that. So what became clear to me is that not that John Hans is an evil man, or not that Dan Gilbert is an evil man, so to speak. We have different views of the world. We have totally different views of the world. And so, you know, when you ask how do we come to the table and reconcile this, it becomes very difficult. So I just want to invite the audience for a minute to think beyond the logic of capitalism. Because a lot of what we see happening is defined by the logic of capitalism. For example, in Detroit, which has been said a couple times, 140 square miles or so, approximately one-third of the land in the city is vacant. About 60% of that land is owned by the city government. Now, city governments weren't created to be landlords and to figure out how to dispense large parcels of land. So the city of Detroit has a real challenge on its hands. And so what they've done is followed the logic of capitalism, which suggests that you sell it off to whoever has the money to buy it. And if you continue to follow that logic, we'll see a replication of the same inequities that we've seen since this country has been created. And so we'll see Dan Gilbert buying 70 buildings in downtown Detroit, now moving his empire down Woodward Avenue and driving the prices up in the North End, where we're doing the Detroit People's Food Co-op grocery store development. If we continue to follow the logic of capitalism, then we'll hear phrases like certain projects are not capital ready, or class A projects, or whatever terminology is used. And so the projects that are capital ready are the projects that are financed by people who have huge amounts of money, which invariably are wealthy white men. And so this speaks to the three fundamental contradictions that we see in the world today. The paradigm, the social construct called race, the concentration of capital in the hands of a few, and the concentration of power in men. And so we see all of these things playing out in the city of Detroit as wealthy white men continue to accumulate large parcels of land and huge numbers of buildings in the city of Detroit. And I would suggest that if we don't begin to think outside of the logic of capitalism, that we'll see an ongoing replication of these inequities. Then we have an even more complex problem because, you know, normally people think, well, if we elect people who represent our aspirations, that they'll function on behalf of the people. But the reality is in America, again, a capitalist system, elections are bought and sold. And we can look at recent elections in the city of Detroit, and we can see that the concentration of capital by people who want to see Detroit move in a particular direction that benefits them is really the deciding factor often in elections. And so we have a problem with that as well. But then also, as I said earlier, we have this responsibility, the residents have the responsibility to organize ourselves. So I don't just want to spend all the time pointing to kind of the structural inequities that exist, although it's important we point those out. But we also have to look at our own responsibility to ourselves. And so when we talk about how do we sit down at the table with people who are extremely powerful in the kind of traditional sense of the word. I mean, we do have power in various ways, but when we sit down with people who are extremely powerful, we can't really play ball unless we are organized and mobilized. And so we have the responsibility to organize our own community so that we function in a much more powerful way. The other thing that as we see large numbers of mostly whites moving into Detroit, again, it's imperative that we have a recognition of this system of white supremacy. Because if not, you have people who come in who might have good intentions, but because they haven't taken the time to study the history and the culture of the community that they're moving into, they can unintentionally function in a way that is anti the majority of people. For example, how many of the young people moving into Midtown or North Corktown know about the more than 60 years long struggle for black political empowerment in the city of Detroit? How many people moving into North Corktown know about the Freedom Now Party that functioned in the early 1960s and the ongoing struggle of black people to have political empowerment? And so if you don't even know about that, chances are very high that you're going to function in a way which is counter to the aspirations of the majority population. So, you know, one of the questions that I don't think we've gotten to yet has to do with re-socialization, but the question is re-socialization of who? So I think that people moving into Detroit, which is really the blackest city in America still, have the responsibility not only of studying the history and the culture of this community and functioning in a way which is complementary to the aspirations of the majority population, but also have the responsibility of doing a deep dig into how this system of white supremacy functions. And so there are groups that do anti-racist training. For example, one of the groups I'm involved with is called Uprooting Racism, Planting Justice, and it meets every first Saturday at the Detroit Center of Michigan State University. And we have these very robust conversations about how white supremacy functions, and both how whites unintentionally internalize the concepts associated with thinking that you're superior, that your culture is superior, that your standards are the ruler by which every other human culture should be gauged. But it also deals with how black people and other people who are oppressed internalize this system of oppression, how we have internalized this concept that we are not as capable and that we don't have agency over our own communities. So I would suggest that, you know, if we're to sit down at the table together, that there's some work that has to be done on both sides. And part of the work that has to be done on the part of whites who are moving into Detroit, who claim to want justice and equity, is that they have to really do a deep study of the system of white supremacy and look at how they're participating in it.
Malik, quickly, I want to give you a chance to follow up. Where did you leave it with John Hance? How did that meeting end?
I think we probably shook hands and said, you know, it was, you know, nice meeting you. But I can tell you this also, that he had almost no interest in hearing about the grassroots urban agriculture movement. The only interest he had is trying to sell me on this capital intensive project that he was pushing. And so there was even no equity in the conversation, frankly. And, you know, I think if we, you know, were to sit down with these other power brokers, that we'll see the same thing, that they really have no interest and very little incentive in sitting down and dealing with grassroots community efforts on any kind of equitable basis.
Okay. We're going to go to the next question. I'm just for the panel's information, I didn't write these questions, so I'm sort of freelancing them a little bit and changing them where I can. So I know you guys saw them before.
I didn't understand some of them. So
yeah, so they may be a little different as I ask them. So, we know that between 2000 and 2010, Detroit lost about 200,000 people, about 185,000 of them African Americans, which left the city without much of its middle class, certainly without much of its historically black middle class. Those were the people who were leaving for the suburbs. And at the same time, we are not attracting black middle class transplants here the way we are white middle class transplants. So tell me about how you address that gap between who's coming and who's not? How do we make ourselves attractive to the black middle class, the black capital that has left the city for the suburbs or for other places?
You know, I've never done a survey on the black middle class who left Detroit and why they left, but my guess would be that most of them left because they want to be safe, they want their garbage picked up on time, they want schools where children are learning to read and write and do mathematics. They want police who are going to respond. They want fire. That a lot of the so-called black middle class would be much more attracted to be in the city of Detroit. Simple as that.
But the reality is that, you know, we live our lives, and there are problems that occur. They don't have to all occur, but we do live our lives and we solve those problems. And I'm a middle class all my life, but it's still been about where is the money. You know, how much money are you able to be involved?
I think too, I'm sorry, do you mind if I jump out of turn a little bit, and to pick up on the woman in the audience's point, I think if you look at overall, you know, the economic status of African Americans in the last 10 years, you know, there's a real vulnerability that, and I think the reality of living in Detroit for many middle-class African Americans, Detroit has become an unaffordable place. And to Malik Yakini's point earlier, you know, there not being equity in the conversations in the region and in the state, you know, quite honestly, African Americans in the city of Detroit have had a list of policy solutions that could have kept Detroit a way more hospitable place. But again, because the narrative in Detroit is such that those voices aren't heard, those concerns are quite honestly most often ridiculed, we've gotten to the point where Detroit, for many middle-class people, is an inhospitable place. African Americans for the last 15, 20 years in Detroit have talked about local control of schools, that's been ignored, residency requirements, the insurance rates in the city. There are a number of issues that progressive and grassroots community people in Detroit have championed over the years that have just been dismissed by the people that control the conversations in the city. So we've gotten to the point, that's why I think most of the black middle class have left. And a lot of the younger and the white people who are moving in, quite honestly, they can afford to. Either they're young enough where, you know, they don't mind, you know, they can afford to.
But push back just a little bit, there are lots of young African-American college graduates who are going to places like Chicago or New York or Baltimore or Washington or Atlanta who we don't see coming to Detroit. So I guess my question is as much about how do we get those folks to show up alongside their white counterparts who are really enthusiastic about downtown and midtown, as it is about why people left.
I think it's a question of value. I was extremely privileged to go to Nataki Taliba Schoolhouse of Detroit and then to Cass Tech, and I left during this period to go to Howard University. And in all of the best intentions of everybody in my community, the measure of success was how far could you get? How far away could you get? For real. And so there needs to be an explicit call home to all Detroiters everywhere, because everybody knows we're awesome. And not a joke. There has to be value placed where we place it, and not just where somebody else starts buying up property and somebody else says it's cool, but how do we place value and say, you know what, this is where you were raised, you are expected to come here and do something. All of the foreign students that I was in school with, whether they were from Tanzania or Trinidad and Tobago or wherever, they were very clear about why they were at university. They were there to gain the information, gain the connections, and then go home and build up where they were from. I think the middle class missed the boat. The middle class thinks chasing after white folks and getting a bigger car, getting a bigger house, and moving out from where you're from is a measure of its success, as opposed to being able to be the link to build up where you're from. And I think that message must be explicitly stated to all of our young people and to all the people who are out here doing wonderful things. All right, Detroit needs you. Come on.
How many people know about the Garden Block Project? Raise your hands. Garden Block, Woodward Garden Block, Woodward Gardens, Garden Theater. Okay, see the absence of hands there? Okay, that was a magical project, an impossible project that was done by a black developer. I mean, it's a 300 car garage. It's a historic building renovation where Great Lakes Coffee is. There's a new office building. There's a 60-unit housing, an impossible project. Okay, then there's Shinola. How many people have heard of Shinola? Everybody, right? So how come we don't know about that project? How come we don't see the PR come across for a project like that that was accomplished by a black man in a black city and did great things? Impossible project. But it was done by a person. So we don't see those examples. So when you talk about young people, they're gonna see Shinola, they're gonna see whatever, you know, all these ballyhoo projects. They're in it. You can look at this last month's New Yorker, there's a two-page spread on Shinola. Okay, there's no two-page spread on the Garden Woodward Garden Project. So we don't know about those projects. Or, the Nanamdi Center, obviously the Nanamdi Center. So we don't know about those projects. Impossible projects undertaken by good men that were able to make it work. And in spite of the prejudices that relate to getting capital, you think it was easy for these guys to get the capital to do these projects? It was impossible.
I definitely, 100% agree, you know, that there's not enough attention brought to that. But there's something that was, just to take a little step back, something that very, very crucial that happened between 2000 and 2010, and that was the housing crisis, the subprime lending debacle. And I'm gonna tell you right now, Detroit was hit the hardest, you know, across the nation. And Detroit really suffered between 2005 and 2009. Detroit was what was the pride of Detroit? Second and third generation home ownership by African Americans. That was the pride of Detroit. Okay, so if you have your pride taken away because of the fact that there was predatory lending, I mean, some of the largest financial institutions right now are paying restitutions. You know, I love what Chase is doing, $100 million. That's beautiful. They owe.
Right.
You know, because if you go down the list, and don't get me wrong, I'm it just is the fact. I mean, if you go down the list, what tore this city up, these communities up, was all this predatory lending. And you can't get away from that because it makes it hard when mama and daddy got to walk away from their houses. See, people started walking away from homes. We didn't do that. You know, we stayed in our communities. We're proud of 48221. But if you got a mortgage, you wrapped up in a mortgage, and all of a sudden you swimming under because of, predatory lending was racially based, but it was motivated by the fact that, listen, I'm getting commission, I'm getting profit, I'm getting dollars motivated by pursuing unconscionably, you know, how they can basically make more profit. And it has been, you know, it's been proven. So I agree, yes, the call comes out, they should come back home, but home ain't there no more. Because see, they walked away from the communities. You know, in some places, they had articles written saying actually saying that was the right thing to do. And so I'm not condemning anybody. It's hard to see yourself. You got a mortgage that if when you don't pay it, it's gonna like all of a sudden triple out, and you know, you got a property you're paying on because you finance it and help, because at one time you could do that, and you could send kids to Howard, and you could send them off to Boston College, and yet you were proud. But when it is that now you caught up in this predatory lending nightmare, I mean, between 2000, I mean, at one point we were like I said, home ownership, you know, that was us, the most 20 largest cities across the country. And then all of a sudden, we by 2009, we're the lowest. Mm-hmm. See, when you own your home, you own your community. Mm-hmm. That's pride. Mm-hmm. So it's hard for you to call back and tell Johnny, come on back home. I ain't even got a home no more. So, I mean, I'm with you on that. 100% they should come back and tribute. But let's be real. That it is still, we are still reeling from that. You know, we are very much still reeling from that. Yes, that is, to me, one of the biggest nightmares about this whole thing is our neighborhoods have been destabilized. Because if you don't have the pride of owning your home, because you couldn't afford to keep it any longer, you know, it really does take away from what is community. I mean, between, again, over 67,000 foreclosures, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, the banks knew. Mm-hmm. You know, so for Chase, I'm proud that Chase has put out the study that they did today. It came out that, you know, they'll partner and make sure that they're doing a responsible thing. You have to, you know, they'll partner and make sure that they get the right training for the Detroiters so that we can, as you say, get re-socialized. I didn't like that. I didn't like that term in the least bit. I had a hard time with it because, you know, you socialize with me. What about socializing the people that's coming in? Mm-hmm. You know, so I got you there. But, you know, that's how you got to put these people on the hook. You got to get them to commit to put dollars back in to basically help us re-enrich our communities.
I gotta jump in here. Thank you. Absolutely. What happened in Detroit before then, because I was in high school, I graduated in 1998. My parents went to vote four times, no on the casinos. We saw foreclosure crisis before all of those predatory loans because the corporate government saw fit to override everything that Detroiters said no to. So we had community casinos here taking people's houses well before that 2008 mark. And so that just exacerbated the whole process when all of the predatory loans came in. And so, yeah, it's heartbreaking because to take someone's rental property or investment property, one thing, but to take somebody's home is a wholly different thing. It's a psychological total deconstruction. So I wanted to put that out there, and it was a test. Can we override what the voters say? Oh, we can. Let's bring in emergency management for the schools. Oh, that worked. Let's bring in emergency management for the city. So there have been several attacks on the sovereignty of the people and the adequacy of the people to govern themselves and choose what's best for them in this city over the last 15 years. Putting that out there.
Okay, anyone else on that question? No?
Sure. You know, I came in late, so I'm going to just a little bit. Let's just go back to the part. The young lady sitting there, sitting in the lead, talking about everybody come home. First of all, in reference to the Africans that go back home, I don't know who told you that. Since they're going back home, they're not doing a damn thing when they get there.
They can't. I don't think everyone can hear you.
Well, just not only the mic, I think you can actually back home. In reference just to the Africans coming to school here and going back, when I was a kid, my dad used to ask a rhetorical question at the table. When are they going home? Now, he didn't mean black people. He meant those foreign white people that were coming, okay? They didn't ever go home. Well, now we've got more foreigners. They don't ever want to go home. The Africans, they don't ever want to go home either. Go home to what, okay? It's just madness for the most part in Kenya, Nigeria, wherever country you go to. In South Africa, now they're attacking other Africans who were aiding them when they were in their struggle. Okay, so that's just half nonsense. As to the handful of whites that want to come back, hey, you could care less. There aren't that many of them coming back. When I was, I used to live right down the street, my family did, right down the street, around the corner, too. Garfield and Forrest on Brush Street. Fritz Jr. home was right across the street. Everybody lived together. In Europe, that would have been called the ghetto, because that's where all the Jews were forced to live. We weren't here by choice, we were here by covenants in real estate deals, okay? And this nonsense about, yes, we were the people who took pride in owning our own homes. My grandmother and grandfather came to see my daddy's new house out on the North End after the war, because we all had that blood money from the defense plans, okay? Those people owned their homes, they paid for them. The next generation didn't want to live there. They wanted to go live somewhere else. The generation of that, after that, they weren't interested in coming back to daddy and mama's homes. They just weren't. They weren't even interested in taking over the businesses. They were all black businesses then, owned by mama and dad, that they had worked all their lives to pay them to go to college, okay? Now, the parts you're leaving out are busing, you're leaving out the Detroit Police Department death squads we had to deal with that murdered us, hey, just like it was a death squad in one of those Central American countries. We didn't do a damn thing about it until some of the little brothers and sisters decided, if men in blue are coming to kill you, they took Richard Wright's grandfather's advice and killed them first. After they started having funerals for white policemen, they began to rethink it. And Bannon, who was the head of stress, said, hey, this is a losing proposition. There are more of them than there are us. Then you're leaving out the heroin epidemic, okay? Where we killed, at some point, we were killing 500-600 people a year. Not crackers killing us, we were killing ourselves. Not there wasn't enough money for all those dope dealers. Then we have the bacon soda epidemic. That's what y'all call crack, which is primarily just bacon soda. And all they had to do was take that out of it, and that would have made it so that they couldn't use it to make that fake cocaine. That would have ended that, but they wouldn't do that. Then we had the war on drugs that everybody wants to ignore, which was just a racist process to put as many of us in the penitentiary as they could. And we didn't do a damn thing about it, out of sight, out of mind. That was black people saying that, not just crackers, that was us. We didn't want those people in our community. So we gotta stop running away from what is our reality, not someone else's, ours. We have to own up and be responsible for ourselves. We've gotta be about making choices we make. My niece went to Howard. Her husband went to Cornell. They've lived all over the world. They've lived here twice, okay? Now they live down there in one of the Carolinas. God-forsaken states. All those white states are terrorist states. We don't want to deal with that. We let the whites get away with not dealing with that, okay?
Wait a minute, just a minute.
We always talking about terrorism in the Middle East. The terrorism is right here.
Sure.
Read Brian Stevenson's book about what's going on in the prison system,
sure,
about the execution of black men, women, and children, okay? And we don't do a damn thing about it. Nothing about it. So, hey, if you don't stop running it down them, deal with us. It's about us, okay?
Thank you very much.
When he was in college. Now, you know what he's done.
Thank you very
right
much.
Here.
We're going to
have
to.
Go ahead,
we're going to try to get some other voices in here, too. Thank you, though. I'm going to ask one last question to the panel, and then we're going to go to the audience questions. We talked about the garden development on Woodward. Chris Jackson, who was on the panel the last time we were here, is developing a site at Woodward and I think MLK that will be black owned, probably not black occupied. In other words, I think the retail outlet that will go in there and the housing that will go in there will probably be mostly occupied by white people. We see Dennis Archer Jr. now saying he's going to open a restaurant right at Campus Martius, and that will be black owned, but I'm sure most of the people in there will be white. Is there something to the idea that African Americans can participate more in the same way that we see new white investment in Detroit that will help change the dynamic, that will help change the dynamic for other African Americans in the city who may not have access to the same kinds of capital or opportunity?
Let me just answer or give you a perspective.
Whoa.
Oh, you're going to take it?
Yeah, you go.
Okay, go ahead.
We'll get to you.
You're stronger than me. Go ahead.
We'll get to you.
I'll just say in my lifetime, I haven't really seen evidence that black people who have the type of wealth to do these kinds of developments generally have the welfare of the larger community at heart. So this is the myth of black capitalism, that if we have one, two, three, four people who are able to foster the development of some project, that somehow that benefits the rest of the community. I haven't really seen that to be true. And I don't want to condemn, you know, all black people who have money, because surely there are some who have a community consciousness. But for the most part, what we see is that those individuals benefit, their families benefit, there may be a few jobs created, but our community is pretty much left to languish. So I want to go back to a point I made earlier, and that is that we have to think beyond the logic of capitalism. The reality is as long as we continue to function within a system that has structural inequalities built into it, that the majority of our people are never going to prosper. And so, you know, clearly, I mean, this is what we're faced with now. We have to figure out how we make do, how we do the best we can while we're in it. But as we're looking at the long term, we need to look at how we think outside of the boundaries of the logic of capitalism.
I was going to say that you know, there is some altruism to investment. I don't want to embarrass anybody by giving the names out, but there are people who have wanted to give back because the city has been very good to them and they wanted to give back. It wasn't all about money. They did it with great heroic effort. But I also want to say that, you know, this access to capital we talk about, it isn't equal. I mean, I would never pretend to say that everybody can get a loan. Everybody can sit across from a local banker and say, yeah, I'd like to have some money because I'm going to buy a house, or I'm going to start a business, or I'm going to expand my printing shop. That just isn't true. I mean, it's hard to get money. It's really hard to get money if you're in the city of Detroit. It's really hard to get money for a project that, you know, the market may not be here. You're trying to start, you're starting the market, you know? And so there's a lot of skepticism on being able to finance projects. We have a lot of atypical lenders that exist in the city to help projects move along, small projects. But they also have criteria. It's really hard to get the money to, you know, the capital to move forward individually or expand your business or build buildings or anything like that. And it isn't equal. It isn't equal because of race. It isn't equal because it's Detroit as well.
Well, I just got to take a moment. I'm sorry. And this is no disrespect to my elder in the room. And sir, I apologize. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. But I want to apologize for the term cracker. It was used twice. I know that the spirit from which he came. But I do want to apologize, because that's not fitting to the dialogue that we're having here. And I just don't think that it should be just out in the air like that. So I apologize to the room and also to the panel here and the level of dialogue we're having. And no disrespect, sir, you are my elder. Or just you're my brother, but I just have to, I'm sorry. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. Again, I'm just apologizing because cracker don't fit in with a positive conversation or an exchange.
Hey, the murder of black people doesn't fit in. Nigga doesn't fit in. What does that got to do with the
problem? Well, when it comes up, I just give me respect the fact that I have right to apologize because it does denigrate the dialogue.
Well, like King said, at a certain point,
I apologize to you.
Reverend King said you can't reason with the irrational.
Okay.
And every white person is
Audience questions. When I read the question, if it's your question, feel free to stand up and say it was your question. All right.
If you don't want to do that, you don't have to do that. First question. It feels to me that our city government and mayoral administration efforts have been striving toward inclusion and aiming to serve and retain existing residents. Most of the exclusionary developments have been privately funded and operated, though some of them have provided lots of economic and recreational opportunities for all. What policies or activities need to be in place or occurring so that continued and future private investments and improvement within Detroit's borders are not, quote, opportunistic or feel are threatening to historically disadvantaged groups? In other words, how do you change the effect of the investment that we're seeing? Anybody whose question is that?
I think a very good place to start would be with the community benefits agreement proposal that several people have been pushing. It's not an end-all be-all, but certainly people who are coming into Detroit doing large-scale development need to, I don't know if I want to say be forced, but yes, be forced to agree to terms that benefits the community that they're operating within and that they're making the profit from. And so that could be a starting point.
Mm-hmm. Humans need water. So the mayor has in his purview the opportunity to shift policy so that corporations and abandoned building owners are first to be shut off, as opposed to living families in the city of Detroit.
If you're in the city of Detroit, you know you're paying high electrical bills. While the rest of the country is doing things like solar energy, and they're reducing the cost of living in cities, taking advantage of the sun, things like that, we haven't gone in that direction. I mean, so these are areas in terms of rebuilding the city. As we talk about people coming in, wouldn't it be wonderful to have a city that's rebuilt on the back of sustainability, a city that really can take advantage of all the modern technologies? We're an old city, and we have old houses, and we have old factories, and old sewers and all that. So it would really be good if the city, from a policy point of view, and not just the city, the state, the government, everybody, try to, bring us into the 21st century in terms of, all the infrastructure and technology.
The whole notion of policy and oversight. If you tie things to, where profit, where the capital, and if you have expectations and you mandate that, and then you have oversight, it encourages transparency. And I think it would, as you said, gets more investment that ties to having a heart and supporting the community.
I think large-scale business and development often talks about having a hard time navigating the city bureaucracy. And I think for small business people and residents, smaller, really super entrepreneurial type people, it is near impossible. So I would love to see a very real small business program for the neighborhoods, for residents, for entrepreneurs and small business people in the city.
All right, I'm going to ask the second question on the back of this. This is a really good question. If there was one book you would recommend to somebody to read about Detroit, what would it be?
I tell some of the young people I got hooked up with some of the VFA fellows, so the kind of Ivy League people who come and intern at different businesses in the city, and I always ask them to read Coleman Young's autobiography. Hard stuff.
The Bible. That's the first thing that came to my mind. Just know the Bible, because I'm serious. Because it is life affirming, and everything. Nothing is new. I mean, I'm sure we can reach back, and there was some gentrification going on and some annihilation of whatever cultural genocide, and then an embrace and then a plan for going forward. So, I mean, truly, I mean, that's, Detroit is rich with some of the best churches in and around, some of the most believing, pastors, and also into community development. They incorporate that as a part of their whole ministry. So they preach from the Bible, and the word is what guides them. I just say the Bible.
I can't say one book. I agree, the Coleman Young biography is a wonderful perspective on, where we are today and how we got here. I think it's a really good book. The Jane Jacobs is the Bible of urban America, or what it should be. That book is studied in almost every university in this country. There's a book that's pretty obscure now. It's called American Odyssey. It's a story of Detroit up from the beginning to about 1970 something. And it's a history. And if we don't know the history of the city, I mean, we don't know how to go forward. I mean, the best way to move forward is really understand where we came, where we've come from, and where we are, and move forward. And that's another book I think is important to understand the city.
You said Jane Jacobs?
Jane Jacobs, yeah. Okay. I can't remember the name. It may be something like American Cities or something. Okay. But that, you should be able to find that.
I'm going to go with one that's applicable, but not necessarily only about Detroit, Naomi Klein's Shock Doctrine and the Rise of Disaster Capitalism.
There's several books. One is Detroit, I Do Mind Dying, which looks at the radical black labor movement that developed in Detroit in the 1960s. There's another book that I read last year, many people probably have read, which is not about Detroit specifically, The Warmth of Other Suns, but gives an overview of kind of the African-American journey and helps us put within historical context where we are today. And I also would suggest that people read Yusef Shakur's biography, because there's a whole kind of underside happening in Detroit that many people don't even know about. And many of you might know of Yusef. He was a gang leader, one of the founders of the Zone 8 gang, and he's become a community activist who's nationally known now. But kind of really hearing that story from a real grassroots community perspective, I think, is a story that's not often told.
That's what I need. Did I suggest one?
You sure?
The Origins of the Urban Crisis.
I wasn't just going to do that. Okay. Take moderator's privilege and suggest Origins of the Urban Crisis, which is Tom Segrue's wonderful book about the role that race and economic play together in the development of Detroit as we see it now.
Shameless plug. The Detroit Anthology.
The Detroit Anthology. That's another good collection of lots of different local writers writing about the city.
Even also Ken Coleman. He has a couple.
Ken Coleman's Today in African American History.
That's also a recent book about.
We could go on for days. Yeah. We could go on for days. All right, next question. Proposal 2. I think I know what this person is referring to, but I'll when I read the question, if you can stand up and make sure I'm being faithful to it, that would help. Proposal 2 was a plan to eliminate inclusion. How do we reverse the legislature and change that policy? I think the person is talking about the Proposal 2 from 2002, I think, which was the anti-affirmative action measure, which eliminated all race-conscious policy from Michigan law. I'm going to start with Kathleen. I suspect this is more up your alley than everyone else's.
I'm sorry. The question you were getting was how do we...
The proposal to was then back on to the all of our legislature to include and set aside and things like that to try to equal the playing field and then around the country. It devastated Detroit. Because I'm a contractor in the construction industry, and I tell you, since that happened, there are a few that have been chosen, but the majority have been strategically put out of business, they don't have access to capital.
That's right.
So until these policies change, and it has to be a collective effort to say, hey, you know, set aside African-American women, we still need those type of programs. Not only Executive Order 22, which Coleman Young initiated, it needs to be more, because we've taken several steps backwards. So how do we polarize in order to make that happen?
You know, it's really is, I'm not an attorney, so I mean, or, you know, but I do advocate, you know, for, again, inclusion, you know, and you got to, it's almost like you got to get strategic, because trust me, you know, a lot of what led to proposal two and thus after, it was strategic. I mean, it's continues and it's slow moving. You know, after Prop 2, you know, you couldn't even say that I'm, really can't even say minorities, hardly. I mean, my cousin, she's over diversity, and she can't, you know, up at MSU, and it changed to multicultural, da-da-da-da, you know. So what I think, and this is just my opinion, what you do is you become strategic in that you try to put people, say, for instance, on the board that make the choices that, you know, that control the votes, that say, you know, this project here, we can fund this, or we will, you know, we're behind this, we'll deploy our capital. You try to make sure that some of those people who are sitting at the table reflect the community that you want to see involved, you know, i.e. black folk, women, or of any other affinity group, and that's, you know, that's just a black and white answer. I mean, you know, you gotta have, if it takes 6 votes, you know, as I said, as you said, Mr. Jackson, who is developing this building over there, he can tell you about the 6 votes. He taught me about that. If you need 6 votes to get you where you need to be, to get the 30 million or the 10 million, whatever it is, to get a piece of this contract, then some of those votes have got to be inclined, you know, and it's not about, you know, being tricky or being illegal, it's about being strategic. So you gotta get, you know, you find qualified individuals who can be a part of your corral of the 6 votes. And then you also do, as you said, get out and you educate, you know, Malik. You make sure that you, you know, as you said, you sat down with the Mr. Hans, or you sit down and as much as you can, you have like-minded individuals like yourself, and you campaign and you, you know, educate those who do control the votes. But there is that there are people who are determined that it doesn't matter. That they're not gonna support. So you gotta, all you do then is you start counting. Where do my 6 come from? Because trust me, that's how it is done. When you know they already have their 6. They got them counted when they go in, you know. So you try your best to have them counted. I mean, it's a matter of, I mean, voting, you know, because some of the people who sit on these boards also sit, you know, can be part of city council, you know. Some of the people who are, you know, sit on the boards of some of these major corporations and who, you know, also are on the investment committee, you know, on the boards, you know, they get voted in, you know. So really that's, I mean, from where my world and my perspective, that's what it comes down, sometimes comes down to. But you're absolutely 100% right. I don't know how we reverse it out. It's the blemish on this state. You know, there are like I could say at the state of Michigan, they have there has been, I know on the investment part, there has been some movement to say, well, we want to make sure it's good business to be diverse. It has to be just a matter of what is good. You know, it can't be this all caught up in we must engage, we must have set aside, you know, all that. And so really that's, we have to be more strategic, because you know, right next door is Illinois. I mean, they're straight out, they legislate, and they hold the feet to the fire. I mean, literally, I've been to their state hearings. It's not a game. I mean, they bring people to, and this is involved with investment management. If they feel that they have not engaged enough with individuals that, you know, minorities, females, and doing business, they will fire. You know, we don't have that kind of stroke. You're 100% right. We don't have it. But we do have to try to put people in those positions that might have a like mind or be willing to, again, cast that vote that helps you get it.
We did a story. There was a report that came out about a year ago, and it talked about, you know, despite the fact that we, the demographic trends of the country are changing, we're in the browning of America. So despite this demographic change in Michigan, and you look at the growing population groups, Michigan is becoming a more diverse state. But the number of contracts that were let, especially in construction and other Michigan state contracts, the people who receive them don't reflect the people, the citizens in the state of Michigan. So, you know, again, as we think about these issues and we talk about them, you know, this is kind of a numbers game, a facts game, and you know, it's the responsibility for media and, you know, people who have a microphone to again just say, you know, this is almost a common sense argument. How is this even possible? That as we look at the demographic changes and as America becomes more brown, the concentration of wealth continues in the same hands.
Gerrymandering. Yeah, I was gonna take a little bit of a moderator's privilege again and give a little bit of a nerd lecture. Some of what we're talking about is about the choices that we're allowed to make at the ballot box, and that is framed by the districts that are drawn every 10 years under the census. The way we do that in this state is a free-for-all. Whatever party is in charge in Lansing gets to draw the map, and analytics and computer software are so sophisticated now that you can come up with a map that would pass constitutional muster that completely marginalizes a majority population, and that's exactly what we have here in Michigan. In the last congressional elections, there were 200,000 more votes cast for Democrats than for Republicans, and yet the split among our legislators is majority Republican. That's because the districts are drawn in such a way that that Democratic voters have less say than they should. Anytime I bring this up, people's eyes glaze over. It's a very complicated issue, and it's really hard to get people excited about. But changing the way that we decide how the districts will be drawn, both for the state legislature and for Congress, would make a huge difference in reflecting what Catherine is talking about, which is that this is becoming a browner state. It is certainly becoming a more Democratic state. When you look at national elections, the state hasn't voted for a Republican for president since 1988. No one's been close. Why then does the congressional delegation not reflect that? It's because of the way we draw those maps. There's a couple people who
My name's Jeffrey, I'm Erica's boyfriend.
Okay. Do you wanna expand on your question? I'm not sure I understand exactly what you're asking.
I think we talk a lot about the 7.2 report, but there's 131.1 other square miles. And I feel like while the focus is on gentrification in that specific area, other areas are getting further entrenched in poverty, in my opinion. I'd like to hear what yours is.
Nobody. I'm always troubled by questions that pit one thing against the other and say, well, which is the most, or which is. I mean, there's so many multiple fronts we need to fight on. So both of the things that you've named need to be combated. I'm not really sure how to weigh that. That's what some people call oppression Olympics, you know, which form of oppression is worse than the other. I mean, they're both bad, and we need to be fighting against both of those.
All
All right, next question. Is there a difference between rich upper-class blacks starting businesses and gentrification? How can pedestrians?
Yes.
Pedestrians tell the difference without a trained eye. Whose question is that?
I am Glenn.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Glenn. Anyone have an answer for that?
What's the question?
Is there a difference between rich upper-class blacks starting businesses and gentrification? I think what he's getting at is there a distinction between maybe sort of what the question that I was asking was, if you see a Dennis Archer Jr. starting a business in the 7.2 or a Chris Jackson developing a building, is that different from the kind of gentrification that you're talking about that displaces people? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Explain it yourself. That's right.
You're on the right track.
Okay.
But,
all right. You want the microphone? Quickly.
Very quickly. You are basically explaining my question. Except it doesn't have to be a political figure. It could be me. Like, I was born and raised in Detroit, and I could be family of a millionaire, and I might want to do something that's not too inclusive to the other demographic of wherever I want to empower or wherever. And you will see that, you could see that. Is it really a bad thing, or is it straight up gentrification, or is it just someone with an idea? Like, with the untrained eye, it's hard to see the difference because everyone will just throw the word gentrification around. So can you throw it on the people who are?
Well, the study I mentioned earlier looked at Chicago, and it looked at racial patterns in different neighborhoods and what happened with value. And the reality is, it really does take, there's a tipping point in terms of the number of white people that move to an area where it becomes the quote unquote hot neighborhood and value really rises. And it has to do really with white skin. That's really all that it is. There are other neighborhoods in Chicago where they looked at how upper middle class or black people moved or started businesses, that the value didn't rise in the same way, that gentrification reinforces segregation, and that the rise in value that we see is related to race.
Mm-hmm. The Washington Post also had a really interesting series of articles earlier this year, or maybe late last year, looking at Prince George's County, which is in Maryland, just outside the district, which historically has been one of the wealthiest concentrations of African Americans in the country, of course, was hard hit by foreclosure and the recession, and has not recovered at the same rate as, say, Montgomery County, which is next door to it, which is a wider county, or counties in suburban Virginia, which have stronger white populations.
So gentrification is only a non-black thing, say that a black person is trying to do it, or it's impossible if you're black.
It's just a buzzword. It's been going on forever. They just want to play it. You got to stop going for those word games.
Yeah. Anyone want to answer? Can black people be gentrifiers? It's a simple way to put it.
Black people can be racist. Black people can be black terrorists.
Okay.
Well, I mean, the term, you know, when you define gentrification, I mean, it's, you know, on the positive, you know, it's about urban revitalization. It's not, so that doesn't have a color to it.
That's why.
So, so, you know, Chris Jackson or I mean, I don't keep want to toss his name around, but, or just, you know, Dennis Archer Jr. getting his grind on and making it happen in the 7.2 mile proximity that is the hot spot in Detroit. I mean, that's it's a part of the, if they're just talking about the concentrated gentrification. Yeah, I mean, but it isn't, you know, just about white people having, or Caucasians. That's why I guess I speak in terms of Detroiters, mm-hmm. You know, because, you know, while the concentrated area, trust me, it's still a lot of, people brown and black that are residents of those areas still too. I mean, it just, you know, it just came, you know, the study just, they just came out recently that 69% of the people that are residents in that, you know, midtown, downtown, it's still primarily people of color, you know. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's the residents and then the people who come in to work, that's a whole different, you know, they can bring in a whole different kind of hue to it. But again, back to what you were saying, is it necessary that, is this, a black person can't get it? No, that, I mean, it's a part of the gentrification. I think what it is more the process of not being participatory that is the concern.
Sister, can you also comment on the class issue? Because I happen to live in this town, and I'm fortunate because I have a decent job. I'm not wealthy, but I'm not poor. I own a law, and when the market went down, there were some people that got closed, you know, foreclosed, they left, the black folks, older people, younger people, including younger white people, that moved in to my small community. And it's actually been quote unquote good for me that white people moved in because my property values are going up. If you happen to be someone that had been renting in that area near where I live, you're in trouble because the rents are going through the roof now. So, you know, it's an interesting thing because we have to talk amongst ourselves among black people about our class issues, even when we love our own people.
Yeah.
And I was reminded of something, if you don't mind me saying, is an anecdote. Years ago, I read of some very nice little couple that was profiled in Black Enterprise, and they bought a brownstone in Harlem, and it was in terrible condition, and they had some, I'm sure, black or brown people that were living there, and they were so euphemistically, quote-unquote, nice about how they were able to get these people out without, you know, just kicking them out. But the point was that they needed to get them out of this building so they could put their middle-class, upper-middle-class dollars into renovating this place, and I'm sure it's a beautiful property. It's probably worth, I'm sure, well over $1 million now. But those poor black folks that had lived there for all these years who have been renting, they're out. They, you know, so they're out by the same skin. You know, but we got to talk about the class issue also.
Yeah, I think race is also often a cover for class. And, you know, we have so many multi-layered ways of distinguishing one from the other and who's good enough to be valued in a conversation, who's good enough to live in a certain place, that it gets really muddy. So to the point of the young man who just asked the previous question, I just want to say, no, you can't be. It's like being a black white supremacist. Sure, you can have those ideas, but the system isn't in place to enforce it in the same way. You will not get the same benefit as someone who looks differently from you because we're several generations into seeing race and class as tied in this larger scheme of things. But absolutely, class. Now, when we get to class though, class doesn't necessarily tie to money, it ties to a mentality. How do you speak to your children? What do you value? What are you leaving as a legacy? Are you able to perceive your existence as further than just what is in front of you for this week? So, you know, we have like so many layers going on and so many struggles because a lot of classes, and some people don't like to be called working class or lower middle or whatever the current labels are, but so many people are in crisis remediation, period. From crisis to crisis to crisis, that there is no time to save or time to repair or to input energy into things that will correlate with education if they were in a different situation or a different city, you know? So I think, you know, it's super multi-layered, but no, black people are not displacing other black people. Bottom line.
Thank you, Charles.
Charles.
All right. This is the last question. What are some artist programs, initiatives that are actively battling gentrification, and how can I, as an artist, be involved? Whose question is that?
That was me last month.
Anyone want to address that? How can artists help battle gentrification? This might be the best for
my mic, so I'm getting ready to end the last question. Well, first of all, as Halima said, my mini me. Okay. Part of gentrification, you know, we can say, you know, people are joining it, but if you're joining Midtown now or downtown now, you're not really gentrifying. You're just joining a movement. It's already been done. You know, you have to be the part of the people who really come in to do that. Historically, African people never will go towards what looks like poverty. I mean, it's not part of it is historically from being enslaved, because if you were enslaved, first thing you wanted to do is not look like you were enslaved, because you could be taken back into enslavement, right? So that's the first thing. So those conditions still exist. So are we just going to go into different communities and take them over? Because we're already in the community, so why can't we do that? Because it's very difficult, and you got to think about that. Now, what I'm always saying, purpose of these conferences and the panels is to have us have this dialogue, because I think it's about empowering. It's not like you don't necessarily want to fight gentrification as such. It's like, if you're concerned about it, get 10 of you. There's a neighborhood with 10 vacant houses in it. Each one of you get a house, $500. You know, and Lima can tell you where these houses are. So get a house, start working on them. That's how you fight it if you think it's wrong. What you do is you become a contributor. You got, you know, and you can really do that. We had Kate, what's Kate? You know, Kate Dowdy, I think it's Kate Dowdy. She's an artist, and she got a house and is in Detroit on the Hamtramck border.
Dodger.
Yeah, okay. Dodger. Yes. Kate, she's not here. Oh, yes. But Kate got a $500 house, and as I said in that first panel, I said, Kate, I can visit, but I couldn't live here, all right? But the thing about it, Kate is buying up another house, getting a cousin to buy another house, you know? So what happens is now, you in a few months, you go over there, or maybe a few years, really, and everyone's gonna be saying, damn, I wish I'd have done this. See, they came and took over the house. But you don't know that Kate living in a house that didn't have nothing in it, you know? It's like got a little wood-burning stove that she put in herself. You know, that's the things that we have to do. And you can do that. But you have to be able to make that type of sacrifice. And in America, it is time to make those sacrifices, because, what they say, this is not your parents' Buick anymore. You're not going to be living like your parents or grandparents anymore.
But George, let me ask you, though. Yeah. But if this is the same Kate that I know, she has the farm, she's the artist.
Yes.
Yes. There are people who have also done fundraisers for Kate that have really helped Kate stay in that space and be comfortable and grow her space. And I'm not saying that we can't do the same.
Let her finish. Let her finish.
I am not, you know, I have all due respect. You know, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
It really is.